Well, our viewers will remember that on the 28th of August this year, five social activists, Varavara Rao, Arun Ferreira, Vernon Gonzalez, were arrested in Pune, Sudha Bharadwaj and Gautam Navlaka in Delhi. These five social activists were arrested by the Pune police. The Pune police accused these people of plotting against the government, plotting to overthrow the government, plotting to assassinate the Prime Minister, and called them enemies of the state. The Supreme Court was approached this next day and all five people were then placed under house arrest until the next hearing. The Supreme Court has given its verdict. The Supreme Court has said, in the bench headed by Justice Dipak Misra, it basically said that they find no reason right now to say that these arrests were made on the grounds of dissent against the government. The court has also refused to set up an SIT for the probe and asked the Pune police to continue its investigation. The court has extended the house arrest of these activists by another 4 weeks, giving them enough time to file bail petitions in their respective courts. Meanwhile, the petitioners in the case have welcomed the judgment but demanded a fair investigation. I also want to remind our viewers the one dissenting opinion by Justice D.Y. Chandrachud actually called into question the impartiality of the judge of the investigation being conducted by the Pune police and the conduct of the Pune police that held that rather questionable press conference while the matter was still sub judice. We have a face-off here tonight on Mirror Now between Nalin Kohli, national spokesperson of the BJP, senior advocate with the Supreme Court, and Mr. Prashant Bhushan, senior advocate with the Supreme Court as well. Gentlemen, many thanks for your time. Mr. Bhushan, I will start with you. The government and the police have called this a matter of vindication. The Chief Minister of Maharashtra has spoken to the press today repeatedly, saying that his police is now vindicated. They have enough proof to show that these activists were plotting to assassinate the Prime Minister. Do you see this as a failure of justice for these five activists?
Well, I would see it as a, in my view, is an unfortunate judgment of the majority. And absolutely rousing judgment of Justice Chandrachud, which is a minority judgment. Justice Chandrachud, in his minority judgment, deals with various reasons. It's a very elaborate judgment, and he gives a large number of reasons of why he finds the Pune police investigation to be unfair, why the Pune police has been behaving unfairly, why there is no evidence to suggest that any of these people were involved in any plot to assassinate the PM or a plot along with Maoists, etc. He says that there is no evidence in the files of the Pune police to believe that. He finds that the procedure adopted by the Pune police of bringing these talk punch witnesses from Pune was not only violative of the law but smacked of malafides. He finds that the press conferences addressed by the Pune police were clearly malafide, where the Pune police flaunted these letters which were handed over to the media in order to get a media trial done in this matter. He found that these letters were claimed to be proof of the guilt of these persons, whereas these letters, according to the affidavit of the police or the government itself, had been just sent for verification, etc. Besides that, you see, there is a large body of intrinsic evidence to show that this investigation was malafide, quite apart from telltale signs of fabrication of these letters. For example, there are Marathi characters in some of these letters which would not be in the keyboard of the persons to whom these letters are sent or the person sending the letter. Mm-hmm. So, then the letters are found in computers of third persons. Neither the person who has written the letter nor the person to whom the letters have been written. Then this FIR, on the basis of which the police starts its investigation, is relating to Bhima Koregaon and this Elgar Parishad. Now, these activists who have been arrested had absolutely nothing to do with that. either the Elgar Parishad or the Bhima Koregaon events. And yet, that same investigation is just expanded further into a plot to assassinate the PM, into thereafter procuring of arms by Maoists, etc. All this smacks of clear malafides, which is what Justice Chandrachud in his judgment has found. And unfortunately, the majority has not dealt with all the aspects that Justice Chandrachud has dealt with to show malafides of the Pune police investigation. And the majority has just gone on the basis that the petitioners cannot choose the investigating agency. Petitioners were not saying that we should be allowed to choose. Petitioners were only saying, have a fair and independent investigation through an independent SIT which is monitored by the court.
Yes.
Because if you allow this kind of an investigation to go on and human rights activists to be arrested on the basis of this kind of an investigation, that would be the end of civil liberties.
Okay.
Or right to life.
Mr. Bhushan, allow Mr. Kohli to respond. Mr. Kohli, there is the majority judgment of 2-1, of course, did say that there was no need for an SIT, that the Pune police was doing a satisfactory job. What is your response to the questions raised by Prashant Bhushan?
No, I think Mr. Bhushan, as I would, or any one of us under who are Indian citizens, have a right to have a point of view under Article 19. So he's entitled to have that point of view. I'll give my point of view and we'll leave it for those who are watching to decide which point of view they subscribe to and which question. So let's, I think, look at the issue in entirety. This was a petition moved directly at the Supreme Court, challenging the arrest and seeking the formation of an SIT. And I would not look at it as technically as Mr. Bhushan is saying. The fact of the matter is their basic prayer was no faith in the Pune police, and therefore somebody aside or the court should set up an SIT monitored by it, which is what they want, in what manner the investigation should be done. Who should do it? A court appointed SIT. And in that there is a body of judgments, and that's what the majority view said. You can't choose your agency which will do it. It has to be said. The second is the very fact that the majority judgment, which is no less than the Honorable Chief Justice of India, Mr. Justice Dipak Misra and Mr. Justice Kanwilkar, they have said that the prayer that was there in terms of saying this arrest is wrong is incorrect. They can seek their remedies before the appropriate judicial forums. But to immediately run it down, in terms of what Mr. Bhushan is trying to say, the evidence and the evaluation of evidence can't take place. The Supreme Court would well understand that it would at that level not evaluate in finality how the evidence is. Because when an FIR is done, it's a preliminary information. And at the stage of that, there has to be only a prima facie evidence or a prima facie suspicion that there is some kind of illegality taking place here. And I imagine, I would ask myself, if the argument of Mr. Bhushan is taken further, then if the Supreme Court is to comment on the efficacy or the correctness or the incorrectness of the evidence, why do you need a trial down? So what is basic jurisprudence? It is, you are innocent unless proven guilty. The police will have to prove that based on cogent evidence. It can't be on surmises, and that will have to be done during the trial process. So I think what has today happened is the opportunity to these five people who have been arrested through a body of advocates who represented them and other people who came forward as petitioners, all of them had a full opportunity to ventilate their arguments before the Honorable Supreme Court. The judgment has come out, and that's the end of the story. So now it is for the police to continue with it. There is no hindrance on the police. And the important argument being taken that the arrest was because of dissent. That has also been rejected by the majority judgment, that this arrest is not on the basis of dissent, because whatever was placed as a preliminary thing before the Supreme Court, and during those hearings, even the court, including Justice Chandrachud, said they are not obviously going to comment on the evidence per se, because it has to be appreciated by the appropriate legal forum, which is much below the Supreme Court. In that also, there is something that makes them feel why this something should be there. Because in continuity, now coming to a political argument, that we've been having an issue related to Maoists or Naxalites. This is continuous, not just the BJP. If I'll go back to Dr. Manmohan Singh's government, in 2013, the government spoke about it. And in the urban, in the Maoist issue, it was flagged that there is a concern that there are a set of people who provide a sort of an ecosphere for Maoists to achieve their activities without necessarily picking the gun, which is through NGOs, through activists, through lawyers, through the media, etc. Now, this is a risk to the sovereignty of the state. Now, all of us, at the end of the day, would have an interest in the security of fellow citizens to take place. So, the political argument that has been raised on the contrary to this is, while the people who were challenging the arrest were constantly seeing malafide in the police or the political establishment have, from their perspective, tried to show or comment about it that they see it as a bona fide thing. So, I think it's been a fair approach. Now, the investigation is there. The onus will be on the police to make it an investigation in which it stands the scrutiny of law. No one can be put in jail and that too convicted unless there is a body of evidence that stands the scrutiny of law through the trial.
Mr. Kohli, the Supreme Court has remanded these five activists to 4 more weeks of house arrest. Don't you believe that if the Supreme Court saw enough merit in the Pune police's case, that they would have been handed over for arrest immediately in custody of the police?
No, I don't think so. No, I wouldn't buy that, because they are before the Honorable Supreme Court in a 32, Article 32 petition talking. And even Justice Chandrachud, in his minority judgment, I am afraid, and I will say it honestly, I was on the highway, so I haven't been able to read the judgment. But whatever I followed when I was in court, there also, while he was making the case about, and that's the basic law point under the Constitution, the guarantee. Every citizen's liberty and guarantee in terms of Part B of the Constitution, fundamental rights, has to be protected. But Justice Chandrachud himself said, when a criminal investigation takes place, you have to balance both. Because obviously, a criminal investigation or the acts of the police are going to in some way be an infringement on those fundamental rights. And even with dissent, he commented in the court, that the dissent, when it goes into the realm of illegal activity or unlawful activity, that right will cease. So dissent is there as an expression, freedom of speech and expression. So let's not even forget Article 92 is qualified or restricted in terms of the reasonable restrictions. There is no absolute right. With regard to your question, I would think it's a fair thing that the court has said, since they are in house arrest, there will be a transition period. The judgment has come out. Let them now go before the appropriate forums. In any case, perhaps, and I speak as an advocate, I don't know what Prashant ji would feel, but perhaps, if they had not approached the Supreme Court, they may not have to have suffered this 1 month of house arrest too. Because how do we know, how can a presumption be made that the courts below may not have granted them bail immediately?
Mr. Bhushan, do you want to respond to that? I just want to read out Justice Chandrachud's observation today in his concluding remarks. He said, the court must be vigilant to ensure liberty is not sacrificed and the voices of opposition cannot be muzzled by those who take up unpopular causes. For the deprivation of liberty cannot be compensated for. But Mr. Bhushan, respond to Mr. Kohli's argument that had these five activists not maybe approached the Supreme Court, maybe they would have been granted bail to begin with.
You see, bail is one thing, but the whole process of an unfair investigation is a different thing altogether. That's what Justice Chandrachud also said in his judgment, that look at that Nambi Narayan's case. He was subjected to an unfair investigation, as a result of which he was incarcerated for some time, and now 24 years later we have had to award him 50 lakh costs, etc. But that's not going to recover the pain that he suffered, or the injury that he suffered, or loss of reputation that he suffered. So today, unfortunately, in India, because investigations take so long, trials take so long, that if a person is unfairly targeted by an investigating agency and he is unfairly charged, then he may spend the next 10 years fighting that litigation. Usually those persons, if they are charged under UAPA, usually they remain in jail. Ultimately, they come to be acquitted. This is what has been happening in so many cases. After 10 years, 12 years, they come to be acquitted. And the police officers, unfortunately, the police officers who have used fabricated evidence to charge them, they are not prosecuted thereafter. And these persons' lives get destroyed. So that is another reason that Justice Chandrachud has given for saying that just saying that the law should be allowed to take its own course and if they are innocent, they will eventually get acquitted is not good enough. If at the threshold we can see that the investigating agency is not acting or investigating fairly, and he has given a large number of reasons. He says that there is no evidence to suggest that these activists are either involved with the Maoists or any evidence to suggest that they were involved in the plot to assassinate the PM. These letters, etc., which were flaunted by the Pune police in their press conference and then thereafter given to the media to hold a media trial, the Justice Chandrachud has castigated the police for that, and most of these letters are clearly fabricated. There are so many telltale signs of fabrication. Why would a third person be having in his computer a copy of a letter written by one Maoist to some Maoist, alleged Maoist commander, that a third person should have that letter in his computer which the police will recover in a... And these letters have Marathi characters which were not there in the computer, or that Marathi language was not even known by the person who was alleged to have written the letters, etc. So therefore, there are so many signs. Then these letters are written to and from one comrade Prakash, and that comrade Prakash in Sai Baba's judgment is supposed to be Sai Baba, and at that time Sai Baba was supposed to be in jail. So these letters are alleged to have been written to a person, to a Maoist who was in jail, by persons outside, etc. Yes. So there were so many things. Then you bring these talk punch witnesses from Pune and total violation of the law, where the law says that you are supposed to have independent local witnesses, etc., to for the purpose of showing that you have sealed the computers properly, etc. And this is what has been happening. They have been just seizing these computers and pen drives, etc., fabricating some letters, etc., inserting in those computers and pen drives, and thereafter then flaunting those letters, saying that we have recovered all these letters. Now, that is why Justice Chandrachud said that since there are many signs which suggest that this is not a fair investigation, therefore, all that we are doing is to ensure that there is a fair investigation, we will set up an SIT. And in fact, Justice Chandrachud in his judgment says, list the matter after 3 days for setting up an SIT, which suggests as if that his judgment was supposed to have been
the majority. But Mr. Bhushan, aren't you conveniently ignoring the majority judgment here, which... Aren't you conveniently, first of all, ignoring the majority judgment here, which didn't find need for the SIT? And secondly, if your argument really was that the Pune police was framing these five activists, then shouldn't that have been a different argument altogether than the one that was presented before the Supreme Court? Because the Supreme Court did not examine the evidence.
No, the Supreme Justice Chandrachud did examine the evidence in order to come to a prima facie conclusion that there was no evidence with the police to suggest the involvement of these people either with the plot to assassinate the PM or with Maoists, etc. Now, that's true that it's a prima facie examination of the evidence, but coupled with all these things that the Pune police did, that is, broke all rules and protocol, etc., went to address press conferences saying that these people are guilty on the basis of these letters, which they in their affidavit say that these letters have just been sent for forensic analysis, etc., and those letters bear telltale signs of fabrication. Therefore, Justice Chandrachud said that, look, there are so many irregularities in the manner in which the Pune police has gone about things, and that's why this is the majority judgment is liable to be reviewed, because the majority judgment has not dealt with the reasons given by Justice Chandrachud in his minority judgment for holding that this Pune police investigation is a mala fide, unfair investigation.
Okay. Mr. Kohli, respond to this accusation.
While he has dealt with the reasons given by the majority.
Respond to the accusation that the Pune police was framing these five activists.
So, I think, Faye, let me, without it being a comment on the judgment,
are you
per se, if I look at it independently, a counter viewpoint can be taken. There was a whole body of activists, lawyers, other people who from the day of the arrest onwards tried to build a narrative in the media that this is innocent, there is mala fide. And one would ask the question to oneself that then was this whole body of activists and people on television saying, no, no, these activists are, five of them are only innocent, the police is mala fide. Perhaps the police thought it that they would like to speak their version. Are they not entitled to? It can't be a one-way street. So therefore, that might be also the argument. Perhaps, I don't know, I haven't asked the police, but maybe this point may have been in their minds that we also have a right to put out our point of view. Second is, who will appreciate evidence? It can't be Mr. Bhushan or me or you or anybody else. It would be by the appropriate judicial forum, and that is the court. And that's why the test of scrutiny is there. Let me take it to the next point. When Mr. Bhushan raises the point about Nambiar Nair case, which, of course, these are the miscarriages of justice, there is no doubt about it. And each one of us feels that pain, and we have a concern too. But the solution of that is not related to this case. The solution to that is to find how do we bridge those gaps through the involvement of the courts and the executive and the legislature. For example, if there is a botched up investigation and someone has suffered, what should happen? What happens when false cases are come? Are the false cases only by the police? Citizens don't file false cases. We could talk about the 100 good cases that under the rape law, where real victims of rape and the tough laws have worked there to ensure the perpetrators go. But don't we find examples of the misuse of it also to settle scores? And the courts have come out and said this was false, or say of a dowry law, or even of murder.
Mr. Kohli.
So therefore, the larger question of reform is in the interest of every citizen of us, all of us. I'm not, and Mr. Bhushan and I would be on the same side. There is no question, while we may ideologically have different positions, but the idea is that when the reform of the system is there for the benefit of the citizen, how can anyone say he or she is on the other side? But you can't load it also in the same system to say that no, these five will only be innocent and everything else is mala fide. The appropriate forum is the court. And I personally believe that, you know, if this case had not been at the Supreme Court, and I could be wrong, that they would have approached the court. Because if my information is correct, some of them already are on bail, not even house arrest.
Mr. Kohli, a question outside of this particular judgment from today. Now, we've now had the Maharashtra Chief Minister as well come out today and talk about the fact that these people are enemies of the country and the state, that they were in fact plotting to assassinate the Prime Minister, and perhaps crimes even worse than that. In that case, is the government comfortable still having this case being investigated by the Pune City Police? We don't have talk of the NIA, of the CBI or any other federal investigating agency. We're still putting this in the hands of the Pune City Police, not an SIT, not even the ATS of the state of Maharashtra, which has a very strong reputation, but the Pune City Police. Why is that? As a citizen, I'm still not able to understand why is that.
First, I don't think anyone, and certainly not a chief minister or a police officer, senior officer, is going to make a claim about a risk to the life of the prime minister. It doesn't matter who that prime minister is. Today it is Narendra Modi ji, but we've lost two prime ministers, two plots of assassination. But I don't think anyone would say that as a loose comment. There would need to be something to back that up. It just can't be a loose comment. I mean, that would be unacceptable, and it is, in my opinion, inconceivable. The second point which you are raising with regard to whether handing it over to another agency, personally, I don't know, because I'm not involved with the Maharashtra government or the Pune police, and I would be able to comment for them. But yes, that possibility does exist. And where there is a need, it does get referred. But I think there would be a catch-22 position here, and I speak, if you would permit me, more from a legal point, a legal hat rather than a political hat, that when a question is raised about somebody in terms of their impartiality or mala fide, there can be only two reactions. One could be to wash their hands off, and the person could say, for example, if someone says Nalin Kohli, I don't think would be the right lawyer, or Prashant ji won't be the right lawyer, either one of us would have only two choices. One is to say, I wash my hands off this and I suggest you take someone you think would be fair, or let someone else be appointed. And the counter viewpoint can also be there, but no, I'm going to prove to you that I am the right lawyer because I'm not doing anything mala fide here. So I don't know. But what you're asking, if it involves the Prime Minister, and if there is any plot, it is but expected that this would in terms of be escalated at the appropriate time based on what is the basic evidence. Now, if the basic evidence is in and around Pune city, then logically the dependence on the police there would also be equally important. Mm-hmm. Because after all, they would be the local police who would have the local network and the local things. So right. We don't know. We'll have to wait to see.
We'll have to wait to see. All right. Prashant Bhushan, do you want to make a closing statement before we wrap this up?
And just as
we have heard of plots to assassinate this Prime Minister before, when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat, there were 4 or 5 plots which were supposed to have taken place to kill the then Chief Minister of Gujarat. And when the Supreme Court asked an SIT or the CBI to investigate those cases, all those cases were found to be cases of absolute fake encounter, nothing to do with any plot to assassinate the PM, etc. So this kind of thing is bandied around whenever it's politically convenient. Let us look at how this case started. There was a first FIR of 2nd January in which the charge was that followers of Sambhaji Bhide and this Ekbote and their organizations had perpetrated violence on the Dalits during the Bhima Koregaon march on the 1st of January. In that FIR, the police constituted a team of 10 people led by the deputy mayor of Pune, and they gave a scathing report indicting the Sambhaji Bhide and Ekbote's group. But thereafter, that investigation, which was with the rural police of Pune, that has been brushed under the carpet. And on the 8th of January, another FIR is registered on the basis of one meeting called the Elgar Parishad, which was organized by Justice Sawant and Justice Kolse Patil, in which it is said some inflammatory speeches were made, which were thereafter found to be just poems of Bertolt Brecht, which were translated in Marathi and read out there, some revolutionary poems. And on that basis, an FIR is registered that there are these Maoists, etc., who had given inflammatory speeches. And on that FIR, then they say that they have found a plot to assassinate the PM. They have found arms being arranged for Maoists, huge payments being made to Maoists, all kinds of nonsense on the basis of fabricated letters have been said. And that, I mean, bogus, totally malafide investigation has been going on, in which you are just expanding the scope of that and arresting more people and human rights, well-known human rights activists who are known dissenters.
So Mr. Bhushan still argues the malafide intent of the investigation. All right, Mr. Kohli, very quickly, closing
statement.
30
seconds I'll take because I need to shift my show. I have to go to another show. Thank you. Just a closing comment. One is, I think an investigation is always an ongoing activity. And it does not mean that an investigation in one case will not lead to something else coming up. Because if there is a network that leads to it, or investigation even stumbles upon something, the police is duty bound to expand it into that and look at it. So I would not say it's a watertight scenario. It can never be. The second is, I just want to thank both you and Prashantji for a very civilized debate. And that's how it should be. We may have opposing viewpoints, but with Prashantji and we both have been able to put our points of view, and it's for the viewer to finally decide. So I will thank both of you for that before I rise. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to thank both of you as well, Mr. Bhushan, Mr. Kohli, for your time this evening. But we'll continue to keep a close eye on this one particular case of the 5 activists who are now going to remain in house arrest for the next 4 weeks, giving them enough time there to file a bail application with the Sessions Court in question. We're going to take a quick break. On the other side, we'll have another very interesting discussion. While all of this movement has been taking place, petrol prices have been moving up every day. We're now paying upwards of 90 rupees and 60 paise in the city of Mumbai. Daylight robbery. On the other side, don't go anywhere.